Hello, and welcome to another edition of UDC Forum. I'm Dr. Sandra Jowers-Barber, Assistant Professor of History at the University of the District of Columbia, and your host. The Association for the Study of Negro Life and History, now called the Association for the Study of African American Life and History, was founded by Dr. Carter G. Woodson in 1915 in response to the lack of information on the accomplishments of African Americans. Dr. Woodson, who died in 1950, didn't start his formal education until he was 20 years old. From that late academic beginning, he went on to become the second African American to earn a PhD from Harvard University. He established Negro History Week in 1926, and 50 years later in 1976, that week became a month-long celebration that today is supported nationally and internationally. With me today to discuss the significance and ongoing importance of the association is Sylvia Y. Cyrus, Executive Director of the Association for the Study of African American Life and History. Welcome.
Thank you, Dr. Jowers-Barber.
It's a pleasure to have you here. I'm going to start with that question that students and everyone else ask, or the statement they make. Why did they give us the shortest month in a year to have African American history?
And I'm going to respond with my canned answer, which is, what have they ever given you? February became Black History Month, in part because of the association, but most importantly because Dr. Carter G. Woodson decided that it was time to stop celebrating individuals as it related to our history. We did not just start in 1926 with the beginning of Negro History Week celebrating African Americans in history. After the Civil War, African Americans celebrated Frederick Douglass's birthday and Abraham Lincoln's birthday. And when Dr. Woodson saw that these types of celebrations were beginning, he said it's time to stop and look at the accomplishments of our people as a whole. And so he picked the week between the birthday of Abraham Lincoln, the president, which was February 12th, and the date that Frederick Douglass celebrated as his birthday, which was February the 14th. He started Negro History Week in 1926, and then in 1976, this association went to the world and said, a week is not enough. And so that is how February was created by us.
Oh, I like that. Now I'll be able to tell my students to calm down, and it was a selection of Dr. Carter G. Woodson.
Absolutely.
How is the association changing with the times? Because there's this question, ongoing question, of the need for an association that's directed to African American history. Isn't the history out there now?
It's kind of interesting that people say that, because Black people are still making history. And so we can't keep up with all of the history that's being made in publications and scholarly articles and even coloring books. So it takes an organization like ASALA, which is how we pronounce our acronym, ASALA, to promote, to create, to disseminate the contributions of African Americans, not just here in America, but across the world. We are still extremely relevant, and especially in these days when individuals talk about America being post-racial, we know that that's not the case. That it, again, was Dr. Woodson and this association that really began the conversations of multiculturalism. So we're very relevant, and we need everyone to be a part of what we do to promote our history.
And how do you do that? How do you promote and disseminate the information?
Well, there are a couple of different ways that we do it. We have a scholarly conference, which is held each year in the fall. And we ask scholars and lay folks who do their history to come and present at that conference so that new scholarship can be shared. From that conference and from others' work, we publish the Journal of African American History. Dr. V.P. Franklin is the editor, and that is the premier scholarly journal. It is the first journal that was created to promote our history. And in addition, we have non-academic events that everyone can be a part of. We have a wonderful Black History Month luncheon that's held in February each year, and there we celebrate the accomplishments of African Americans. We always have a dynamic speaker who comes and shares with us information about our annual Black History theme. So our publications and our events And our membership groups, like branches, we have branches that are across this country where groups of individuals get together and plan programs, study local history, share that information with school districts and in the community. So there are a lot of different ways that we maintain the mission of the association.
Is there a special way that you reach out to young people? Is there an intentional focus on getting them involved?
Absolutely. Even though we understand that for you to really appreciate history, you really have to have a few years under your belt. And we do, you know, hear from students sometimes that they say, well, you know, is history just about dead people? Well, of course it's not. And the more that we engage school children, whether it be in the public schools or charter schools or even Sunday schools, the better that there's an understanding among our young people that they are standing on the shoulders of great African Americans whose place they must take. And so they really, really respond to it. We also work very hard and very heavily in the HBCU community, mm-hmm. and the college community. And our students there, even if they're not history majors or African American study majors, they could be journalism majors or in other areas of arts and sciences who get involved in the history and are really encouraged by it and inspired by it.
You talked about school teachers and churches. Wasn't that the initial focus and the avenues that Dr. Woodson used to disseminate the information?
Absolutely. When you think about when this association was started in 1915, you could count the number of PhDs on your hand with a few fingers missing. And so it was important to Dr. Woodson to make sure that the scholars got that information into the local community through churches and school groups and individuals who had their own organizations. So being connected to the community was always very important to Dr. Woodson as it is to the association today.
Now I know that the association has an oral history project. Talk a little bit about the significance of documenting the experiences of your members.
Well, we actually participate in a few oral history projects. We work with the Library of Congress with a veterans history project, connecting the stories of those individuals, those African Americans who served in conflicts around this world on behalf of America. We also do a digital storytelling project with the National Park Service, where we capture these stories again. And then we do individual oral history projects as they come up. But it is so important for us to talk about these stories, mm-hmm. and share these stories and document these stories. And the reason why I think oral history is so important, even as it relates to videos, is because that's the way that our young people are getting information these days. So we're videoing it, we're writing it, we're sending it out every way that we can so that individuals know the importance of African Americans.
How you have such a passion for this? How did you come to be the executive director?
It's kind of a funny story, I think. I moved to the Washington, D.C. area, which is where ASALA was headquartered. And the then president, Dr. Gloria Dickinson, asked me if I would come in as an interim to move the office from Silver Spring to Howard University, where we are delighted to be today, and to complete our conference that year. And as a result of sitting at the desk and in addition to packing up everything, I saw some of the great projects that the association could participate in. I kind of dug in and it just became something that was a part of my life. And I was fortunate enough to be asked by the then executive council to serve. And now I've been in that job for 10 years and I really do love it and really appreciate all the work that folks like you and others do to promote and write our history.
What are some of the challenges that you're facing?
Well, I think that as for this nation and many states around the country, the economy makes it very difficult to really focus on history and current issues that don't deal with the services of around housing and food and what have you. So there is a challenge just in the economy to get folks to understand that we have to spend resources of time and money to make sure that our libraries are maintained, that we go out and find the papers of individuals who have made a great contribution to our history, and to get involved when our own lives are so challenged. ASALA has a number of volunteer opportunities that we have for individuals. And so we say to folks, take a little time out of your busy day when you're stressed and strained by work to come on out and do something that really contributes to African American history. And I think that if we could get that message out more, I think that we would do better.
As you expand your base, do you see your audience or your membership changing? You see younger members coming in? Do you see those coming in with perhaps an idea of finding out about African American history, not knowing about it, and coming with some artifacts where they found in the basement in their grandmother's old suitcase?
Well, I think the wonderful thing about African American history and history in general is that it is multi-generational. And so there's an opportunity for grandmothers to work with grandchildren to talk about those things, as you say, that are in the basement that they might have poo-pooed and said, oh, it's just something that's an old document. And young people do get interested by that. I also think that with technology, with YouTube and the social media, that young people now can create their own videos and their own stories to help tell those stories. So I think that we see from senior citizens to young people that our history is something that really can be engaged by all.
And you're talking about technology. How has the organization kept up with the times? What's going on is your website? Is it interactive? How have you grown with that?
Well, we have just launched a brand new part of our website, which is more interactive, that allows individuals to go in and search some of the activities that we're doing and see actually their membership and their conference registration and their luncheon registration, which is helpful. But we also have a very powerful Facebook page. We're getting more involved in Tumblr and Twitter and social media in that sort of way. And as a result, we've done more in terms of videos and those type of things. So yes, technology is really helping us a lot, and it's helping to tell the story.
What do you think Dr. Woodson would have thought about the ways that the history is now being presented?
Well, Dr. Woodson was an innovator in his day. Remember that in 1915, when this association started, the whole idea that there would be an organization that was just promoting black history was really unfathomable to most people. So I think that although he might have some challenges, I think that he would really agree that we have to reach people where they are, and particularly when it comes to young people and getting the message far and wide, that the social media in particular allows us to tell this story so it's not just in your own community, but now the community becomes the nation, it becomes the world, and I think he'd really approve.
There is a national monument, or his house is being turned into a museum. Talk a little bit about the progress being made at that, if you will.
Dr. Woodson's home site is located on 9th Street here in Washington, D.C. And we're working with the National Park Service to first secure the structure, which unfortunately was challenged by a recent earthquake and a hurricane. But we are also working to, by 2015, restore the home enough so that we can go in the home site that was the place where intellectuals of the day came in to talk about our history, to talk about publications and books that needed to be written, and individuals who needed to be sponsored to tell our story. And so we are looking to the community to support us. Keep looking at our website at www.asalh.org for information on how individuals can help us restore that site, and also check the National Park Service website as well.
Where do you see going forward? How do you see ASALA positioning itself?
Well, as we look to the future, I think that ASALA will be more involved in activism. We've basically been about telling the story and making sure that it was told appropriately. But I think in these days and times, when we see what's happening in the political structure of America, we know that we've got to send the message to our members and this community that we've got to do more than just read the history. We've got to really take an active part in the community to make sure that our history is told. And so I see that in the future, in coming years, that we'll do a little bit more as it relates to really creating activists who tell that story.
How do you see HBCUs playing a part? They seem to be under siege right through this period. And what is your response to the challenge that they're no longer needed?
Well, of course, HBCUs are needed. In a day when we are trying to get all of America better educated, of course, the important role that HBCUs have played cannot be minimized. We work very closely with HBCUs to make sure that their students and scholars are involved in a very healthy academic environment such as ASALA. But we cannot forget our history and what HBCUs have meant to the education of so many African Americans and others. And for that reason, although I think that because of the economy and some other factors that we're being challenged, we'll rise to the top again.
Now, you said that you're located on Howard University's campus. Talk a little bit about that connection between Howard, the Mecca, and your association.
Well, Dr. Woodson was actually a dean at Howard University. And so when he left his will, he actually talked about this relationship between Howard University, the association, and other HBCUs, as a matter of fact. And so we consider it kind of coming home. We're very close to the home site, which is located on 9th Street. The educational mecca at Howard University is unquestioned. So many great scholars have either studied there or taught there. So it's a perfect place for this association. And we found a great partnership with Howard and the students and faculty in being there.
How do you find your membership growing? Are you pleased with the rate of growth you're seeing? And how necessary is that for your organization to thrive?
Well, I would say that we've seen some growth, but I'd love for us to have 1 million members, and we are quite a bit of ways away from there. But we are growing, and I think that as it becomes more evident to individuals that they can help by just joining the association, going to our website at www.asalh.org and clicking the Join Me link, I think that we'll continue to grow and we'll continue to be stronger. We'll continue to tell great American history stories.
The annual luncheon that you have, you talked about some of the speakers. Just give us, talk about a few of the speakers that have presented at the luncheon.
Well, we've had speakers such as Mary Frances Berry and Kirk Schmoke and Earl Graves and Lonnie Bunch, just to name a few. A lot of individuals who have done great works in African American history, civil rights, culture, etc., come to ASALA to really give back. And it is a wonderful afternoon. In addition to those speakers, we have other events such as auctions and a book signing that brings out from 30 to 50 authors who will sign and sell their books. So it's really a great afternoon for individuals to really get a cultural and historical charge. And information on the luncheon is also on our website.
Now, that's always held in Washington?
It's always held in Washington. It's always held in the downtown area so that it's easy for folks to get to. We have individuals that come in from all across the country to this luncheon because it is the mother of all Black History Month luncheons.
So, how old is the luncheon?
The luncheon is actually 87 years this year, and we're looking to continue it in great ways and great venues with great entertainment and edutainment for that event.
Throughout the year, do you give presentations? Are you participating on panels, spreading the doctrine of the importance of African American history?
Yes, the association and our members are invited to give talks and participate in programs all across this country. And so we take that as a great opportunity to spread the word about ASALA and about our history. So if individuals have events that they are interested in having someone from ASALA speak at, they need only call us and we'll see if we can make sure that we have a presence there.
Now, what is the structure of the ASALA? You're the executive director. Do you have a board?
Absolutely. We have a board that is called the Executive Council. It's made up of about 25 members. We have an elected president, vice president, secretary, and treasurers. And we're looking for individuals who have experience in business or law or accounting who might be interested in giving back through service on a board to reach out to us to help us in that way. So we're very interested in individuals who may know a little bit about history or really like history, but have skill sets that they'd like to help us with, to look at our website as well and look at when we're looking for executive council members and come on out and join us.
Now, there's been great growth, I understand, in the number of people coming to the luncheon and also attending the conference. And I believe that Dr. Woodson's, the first intention was to make sure that teachers and educators, but it's opened up to, as you said, to others coming.
Absolutely. When I came to the association a number of years ago, basically the panels were comprised of scholars who talked about their research. But as we've grown, we have expanded the program to about 175 panels that take place at that conference, so that there is room for not just historians, but other areas, other disciplines, but so that lay historians and individuals in their communities have done research, have a venue to have their work vetted as well.
When you select the conference sites, are you looking to an eye toward African-American historical sites?
We absolutely are. There are a lot of great places around this country that can hold a conference, but we are very particular about looking at places where there is a strong African-American historical background. And so that leads us in many cases to places like North Carolina and the Carolinas to the South, but also in the North and the West as well. But we do look for places that really provide, especially important to us, our Black History tours, where the individuals who come to the conference can actually ride around the streets and see some of the structures and institutions that make our history.
Do you provide opportunities for youth at these conferences so they can be involved?
Absolutely. We have two ways in particular that youth participate in our conference. We actually have a youth day that is facilitated by KEYUMSHA, which is a youth empowerment group located in Prince George's County, Maryland. And we also coordinate with youth groups and school districts in the cities that where we hold the conference to do that. But we also have a teacher's workshop where we teach culturally responsive teaching techniques. And we actually have youth come in to learn the lessons that are taught by our facilitators so that they can actually work with the teachers on training and our lesson plans and that sort of thing. So there are many places that they can be involved. And we also take high school students as volunteers for our conference and our luncheon as well, so that they can rub shoulders with some of the greats that make our history.
The teachers' conference is especially important when you hear of incidents such as the teacher having the slave auction for the five-year-olds, and you understand that there's some cultural sensitivity and education that needs to go on.
Absolutely. That really, really is so important. Teachers have such a difficult job these days, and I know that sometimes well-intentioned, sometimes not, but the training is so important. And we say to teachers, if we're in a conference in your area, come out and participate so that you could get some of the great training that's needed to make your job a little bit easier, but and also help reach your students.
What materials do you make available?
We have a Black History Bulletin, which was created by our first woman president, who was a very close and dear friend of Dr. Carter G. Woodson, Mary McLeod Bethune, who was our president for 10 years. And she and Dr. Woodson came up with this publication for teachers by teachers. And so that's one of our publications. We also have theme products that come out. We have posters and other publications that will be helpful to teachers for their classrooms. And as I said, we always talk about Sunday school teachers and other places where children can learn.
So someone can come to the website, a teacher can get lesson plans, can get materials, and be prepared to take them to the classroom.
Absolutely.
This has been wonderful. One of the things that, and challenges, and I'm sure you hear as you go around, that these organizations are not needed. You've presented a great case why they are needed. For instance, if you are asked about the significance of a woman being president of this organization.
Women have been president of this organization, as I said, going back to Mary McLeod Bethune. I think that women, and particularly as we look at events like Women's History Month that celebrate women, that women bring a different a different approach to leadership. And I think that it is important that we train up our young women so that they can lead. I think it's important not just for our institutions, but also at home for women to understand the role that they play as leaders. But as it relates to history, certainly it's important that as you sit on a woman's knee, that you learn the importance of where you came from and what you have to contribute.
And so you're looking toward the future with an eye for Salah to continue going forward and being a leader in making sure that the history of African Americans is disseminated widely.
Absolutely. That is our mission, as it has been since We were founded in 1915, and we look to the community to help us reach that goal of making sure that every person knows about the contributions of African Americans.
I'm very glad that you have such a positive attitude, and I do understand the significance. We always have our students attend luncheons and volunteer, and it's amazing that they come away not knowing, having not known about Dr. Woodson, but they learn so much at that conference and just meeting individuals who are such figures in history that it provides them an opportunity to see some of the people that they read in class.
That's right. It really is so important. And we speak Dr. Woodson's name just like we speak of the other greats in our history. And I think with that, that our young people will start connecting that it's not just a few, the top 10 African Americans, like the great works of Martin Luther King and Malcolm X and others, but there were thousands and tens and hundreds of thousands of African Americans who've made a difference. And I think by working with children that way, that they'll understand that they too must be history makers.
And it's really interesting when you tell them that he did not start his formal education until he was 20, which gives hope to a lot of individuals. And to become the second African American to get a PhD from Harvard, his story is amazing.
It absolutely is. And being the second PhD from Harvard is no easier today than it was then. It's still a very challenging job, but even with the resources that he had, he was able to achieve great things. And that's really the story that we want to say to our young people is, bad schools are not a new thing for African Americans or for this country. Mm-hmm. Formal education has always been a challenge, but if you have that drive and that will inside you, you can accomplish great things. And that's the story that our history tells.
Thank you so much for being here. Thank you so much for sharing the history of Osala with us. And we look forward to many more years of leadership and direction from your organization.
Thank you so much.
If you would like more information about the Association for the Study of African American Life and History, you may visit their website at www.asalh.org. If you want more information about the academic programs and events offered by the University of the District of Columbia, visit the university's website, www.udc.edu. Thank you for watching. I'm Dr. Sandra Jowers-Barber.